Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. So, Happy New Year, one and all. How was your New Year's? How many stayed up to midnight?
Nobody else in my family named Debra. Why? Well, it turns out back in the 1950s,
still, you know, the studio system, they had on contract this B-movie actress named Debra Paget, D-E-B-R-A-P-A-G-E-T, and she usually was cast as the exotic brunette girl in various forms. And in fact, the two big roles that she had in the 1950s is, one, she played the water-bearing girl in the Ten Commandments, and two, she kind of rose up there in stature, where she wound up being actually the co-star of Elvis Presley in the movie Love Me Tender. Now, how that influenced my mother to name me Debra, I don't know. You figure it out. But what's interesting, that if you look at the original word Debra, D-E-B-O-R-A-H, which is one of the named judges in the book of Judges in the Bible, Debra is a great judge. She was the one that sort of ruled or interceded or made decisions in adjudicating various arguments and such like that. But Debra in Hebrew means queen bee. Now, it's interesting that my father, being first generation American, he named me Deepyard. Now, Deepyard doesn't sound anything like Debbie, but he thought it kind of sounded like Debbie. I think my father's hearing needed to be checked. But Deepyard actually means as pretty as a butterfly. So you get queen bee on one hand and butterfly on the other. I almost have the etymological spectrum kind of spring in there. You know, but think about it. What about your name or the name of your children? And why were you named that? And what does it mean to be that? Were you named after a particularly famous B-movie actress? Were you named after a grandfather who was well-beloved? Were you named after a car? I mean, I don't know how many people really are named Mercedes, much less Volvo. Anybody want to share about maybe why your name is what it is?
It's my mother's name and my grandmother's name.
Okay. Anybody else? Okay. Probably you didn't name Oreo, right? You weren't naming your kid or yourself after a cookie. But anyway. But when we name something, it is sort of a sense, it's sort of an entitlement of owning something, that thing being named belongs to you. And sometimes also too, it sort of indicates that you can kind of wrap your arms around what's being named so that it seems like you get a better idea of why it's there and what it should be. And so, not surprisingly, over the centuries, talk about really centuries, because I go back to, last week I went with my cousin to see the Ramesses exhibit at the Beyond. I'm seeing a nod there, and you've seen it. You got another month to see this before it goes. This guy reigned for about 60 years. I mean, he was maybe 10 years short of Queen Elizabeth II, but he reigned for 60 years, and he put his name on everything. There is just statues and monuments everywhere. Ramesses here, Ramesses there, Ramesses everywhere. He's the same Ramesses that if you saw the Ten Commandments, he was the one played by Yul Brynner compared to the Moses played by Charlton Heston. So let's put a little historical context there. But going all the way back to that number of years, 1300 years before Christ, BCE, people have tried to figure out who God is. What God is. What do we call God? Do we even use the word God? It's interesting to note in this little pamphlet I picked up from a Christian bookstore a couple years ago about 21 names of God and their meanings, that the most often used names of God is Jehovah or Yud-Heh-Wah-Heh, Adonai, Elohim, and El. So that the first name mentioned in the Bible, the fourth word in the book of Genesis chapter 1 is Elohim. Elohim meaning the all-powerful one. And sometimes it's El, which just means God. And sometimes for the Jews, saying the word Jehovah, which we kind of said it's Jehovah, they would have said, they wouldn't have dared to pronounce Yud-Heh-Wah-Heh. They just said Adonai, that just meant Lord, that all of that was just, that God was too holy for them to even dare to mention that name. So they came up with a lot of other names. And if you look at this thing, it's kind of filled with names of God. And so, but it helped them to try to figure out, so is God the strong one, the most high, the all-powerful creator, which is Elohim, El Shaddai, the all-sufficient one, Emmanuel, Emmanuel from Advent, God with us. So, who is God? What do we name God? And, thinking of another book that I had in my bookshelves, it's this book, which is very thick, so you're thinking, oh gosh, how many names of God are there? 365 names of God right here, okay? This is written by one of my favorite Christian authors, Sister Joyce Rupp. She is a Servants of Mary sister who is a poet as well as an author. And she has here 365 glimpses of the divine for daily meditation. And it's the book itself is called Fragments of Your Holy Name. So just bear with me as I read a little bit of explanation here. No one knows for certain who voiced the first name for divinity or when this happened. You know, at some point in history, a stirring in the human spirit led to this significant moment. Did this take place when a man or woman felt a curious desire to name an unexplained inner presence? Perhaps it was during a quiet time as they contemplated the recurrent changing of seasons, or after a person died a tragic death, and the questions arose about what comes after, the afterlife. Countless titles have been given to divinity from earliest times down to the present era. In fact, if you followed, this is the 100th, this last year was the 100th anniversary of the discovery of the tomb of King Tutankhamun. And what had been initially one of a pantheon of many gods, he would have been called Tutankhaten. But his father tried to get rid of all the other, probably a lot of gods, and just say God. So he said Amun. And so he became Tutankhamun. And so he's Tutankhamun in his short 6 years on the throne tried to undo all of the problems of getting rid of Aten because it turned out that it caused a revolution in Egypt. So he tried to go back to the original way of the way God looked at. Anyway, the countless titles given to divinity from the early times until the present era reflect humanity's attempt to communicate with the veiled presence. So, naming a divinity within certain religions evokes a profound solemnity. Some faiths will not voice the entirety of the God in one's name due to reverence. Remember I said about Jehovah, the Jews would say Adonai, just say Lord. And Christians profess their belief in the power of the divine name by ending their prayers with, we ask this in the name of Jesus, or in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And they're encouraged, as was read just now, to bend the knee at the name of Jesus and to gather in his name and in their universal prayer, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Now, among the many fragments of the 365, I will not read to you all 365 because you'll probably revolt and run away. But I wanted to share when this wonderful resource of daily meditation. And I just want to take five of the words that she talks about. That, you know, God is just too big, like the gospel hymn. God is too high, too wide, too big. And you can't wrap your arms around what God is. And so we have fragments. We've given names that are really kind of fragments or facets of God's inner character or essence. And so I wanted to start with, as I said, I'll give you five of the names that she's calling out here. And one of the names of God she calls out is Refuge from the Storm. I thought I'd start with that one. And what she wrote is quoting from Psalm 57. I found needed shelter from harm. The the day of the violent hailstorm, when I hurriedly sought shelter under the wide sycamore branches, that stormy day reminds me of you, the one whose canopied refuge spreads an eternal awning of love. And when I feel tempestuous strife, I hurry in prayer to your safe haven, and my wild storms inside do no damage. Another fragment of God that she calls out is God as silent potency. She says, you are ready at any moment to stir and activate our potential, to move our lethargy into action, to change despair into hopefulness, to soften love that has been hardened, to awaken slowly dying dreams, to uplift spirits caught in sadness, to guide the mind to clear thinking, to strengthen wills that are weakened, and to free that which has been bound. Your silent potency moves in me. I think I'll end with this one. Another name or fragment of God is friend. Where would I be without you? As my confidant and companion, how would I navigate life's troubles without you there to advise me? Your faithful friendship provides vitality, encouragement, confidence, and endless ingredients of joy. I learn from you the basic criterion of what it means to be a true friend. Reliant, accessible, and trusting. I spend time with my friends. So, over the holidays, some of you might have been binge watching The Crown. I know the bishop said he was trying to catch up. I said, so where are you? And he said, I'm on season one. I said, what? There are 5 seasons now. He said, well, we didn't watch it at the beginning, so I'll check in with him when later in the week to find out how far he got through The Crown. Anyway, some of you might have seen The Crown this last season, season 5. There is, I guess, in the ninth head. And there is a reenactment of what happened when the Queen in the Guildhall on her 40th anniversary of her reign made this pronouncement that 1992 was an annus horribilis, a horrible year. And why was it a horrible year for those of you who don't remember? Well, for one, there was the divorce of Princess Anne from her then husband, Mark Phillips. There was the separation of Prince Andrew from the Duchess, Sarah Ferguson. Then there was the bombshell of the release of Andrew Wharton's book, Diana, in which she detailed the breakdown of her marriage to Prince Charles and his carrying around with Camilla, who is now the Queen Consort of England. And then the last, to add, you know, insult to injury, according to her, for this annus horribilis, was the fire, the devastating fire in Windsor Castle. And I think a side note to that is, after that, because the taxpayers had to help pay for the repairs and the restoration of various parts of Windsor Castle, she had to start paying taxes, and she had to open up Windsor Castle, and more especially Buckingham Palace, to the public to visit when she wasn't physically in those palaces. But anyway, so we have finished 2022, and I don't know if you would have called it annus horribilis, if you would have called it, well, I think right now we could call it the year of the atmospheric river. I'm not sure how you would name it if you've a mind this past evening of New Year's Eve or even today to figure out how was this past year for you. So again, give a shot in naming the year. And if you don't want to name 2022, with some hopefulness, name 2023. And we could say, let's hope it's not an annus horribilis. Let's say maybe it's a year of potential. My grandson will be graduating from TCU. Ooh, TCU won over the University of Michigan at the Fiesta Bowl yesterday. Cuts to the core, my husband was a some say in how it turns out versus having a year that happens to you, how you might in that way kind of tame what happens in 2023 so that you might be able to discern what God has in mind in your life's journey. So you can see if you do more than a reflection of 2022 all the way back to many years back in your life, do you see a kind of trajectory of where your life has been and where it's going and where you hope it might lead to in 2023? It's something to think about. Something to think about. And no matter how you think of 2023, hopefully a year of great potential, of great discovery, of great reconciliation, peace, joy, love, happiness, more Oreos, I mean the cookie, not my cat. To think about and to name it. And sometimes by naming it, you create that, you create the potential or you create the possibility and actualize how that year is going to turn out. But no matter how you name 2023, know that God is always with us. From the beginning to the here and now and the ever shall be future, God is Emmanuel, God with us, Yeshua, the Savior, Lord of our hearts and souls, that God is always with us.